Good morning, everyone. So I'm sure you know what I'm going to be talking about this morning. It's our Christmas Bazaar and Candy Cane Cafe coming up on November the 18th. Some of you have already signed up on the sign-up sheet, which is in the library, but we do still have a few openings. And what I'm specifically asking for today is two people that might do 2.5 hours at the table at the entrance to the hall to welcome the people that are coming in and to take their money for coffee and a treat in the Candy Cane Cafe. So if someone prefers to sit as a volunteer job and will be able to do that, please come and talk to me. I'm dividing it up into two shifts rather than the full time, so to make it easier for us. And other than that, have a look at the list in the library, and if you have any questions at all, please come and talk to me. I'd love to hear from you. Oh, and sorry, I should mention items that we need. Jane Fraser is doing her regifting and vintage tables again this year, and so she's looking for you to go to that drawer where you put the gift that you receive, but you really don't know where you're going to use it, and so you put it in the drawer. I think we all have them. So if you can go through those and find anything that can be regifted or vintage items, maybe some china that's been gathering dust that you don't use anymore, and Jane will be able to take that off your hands. There's a tote, a big tote in the church office. You can have access to that on Sundays or bring it by during office hours. And then the last thing I need to mention, sorry about this, is of course baking, our famous bake table. So we need all of you to think about what you're going to bake for our bake table on November the 18th. Thank you.
Just a real quick reminder about the first and third Wednesday of every month, we gather here in this space and explore some new music and tell stories of the music, where it came from, who has written it, all that sort of thing. And I had a couple of folks last week at coffee time ask me, where does this happen? And so it says in your pamphlet, in the bulletin for this morning, there is a little announcement on the bottom right-hand corner. The only thing I want to correct about that is that we don't go for a full hour and a half. We put that 10:30 to 12 time in, but generally we're done by about 11:40 or so. And you can join people. We have people come from a variety of churches and denominations. We have some Lutheran folk, Anglicans from both Nanus and from Qualicum. We have some folks from there who come, some from the United Churches around, and a couple of Presbyterian folk. And it's just people who gather who want to learn more about the music, where it has come from, who the authors are. They're real people, in many cases, still alive. I like to say that not all hymn writers are dead.
Good afternoon. I'll try to keep this short since there's so many announcements today. Just a reminder that today is the deadline for submitting your pledge forms for 2024. If you happen to have forgotten it, if you could get it to the office by the end of the day on Tuesday, because Holly will be in the office, that would be lovely. It's really important that we get all the returns so that we can budget properly and plan for our future. And this is also a friendly reminder that 2 weeks from today, on the 12th of November, the bishop will be here, and we're going to kick off the day with a potluck brunch at 10:30. So whatever you decide you might want to bring, please have it here by about 20 after 10, so that the buffet table can be laid out in time to start properly at 10:30. Thank you very much, and we hope that we have a really good turnout that day. Thank you.
And one final announcement, had a phone call from the Lutheran Church wondering if anyone here would like to join their choir. So I said I would ask, and if you are interested, then let me know and I'll give you a contact number. Okay, I'm Julian, and we're starting in the grey booklet. We're doing the service of the world, and it's on page 29. And as well as that, you need your bulletin and your inserts. And we're going to start with our inserts. If you can find the prayer, "Dear Lord, I pray you'll enter my heart today." We're going to say this together, and then we're going to sing it. Dear Lord, I pray you'll enter my heart today and calm my anxious soul and wash my fear away. Abide in me, let me abide in you. I sit among my friends as if in Galilee. So come into our midst and teach us what to do and show us how to pray. Help us to be like you. With you in me, I never feel alone. I'll never ever be a stranger on the shore. The whispering of the waves, the sand beneath my feet, the hills, the birds, the sea, shout out you care for me. With you in me, I never feel alone. I'll never ever be a stranger on the shore. Now we'll sing it together.
Spirit
be with us all, and also with you. Let us pray. We thank you, O God, that you have again brought us together on the Lord's Day to praise you for your goodness and to ask your blessing. Give us grace to see your hand in the week that is past and your purpose in the week to come. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, as we turn our hearts and minds to worship Almighty God, let us confess our sins. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Merciful God, grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let's pass the peace in our traditional way. Bulletin, we'll read together the collect. Lord God, our Redeemer, who heard the cry of your people and sent your servant Moses to lead them out of slavery, free us from the tyranny of sin and death, and by the leading of your Spirit, bring us to our promised land. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now we open ourselves to the transformative moment with the first reading.
Hear what the Spirit is saying to the gathering.
Thanks be to God.
hymn had been written in his time, he would have loved to have sung it. We're going to sing Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah, hymn number 565.
Presenting God's message to you, defiant of the opposition. God tested us thoroughly to make sure we were qualified to be trusted with this message. Be assured that when we speak to you, we're not after crowd approval, only God approval. Since we've been put through that battery of tests, you're guaranteed that both we and the message are free of error, mixed motives, or hidden agendas. We never used words to butter you up. No one knows this better than you. And God knows we never use words as a smokescreen to take advantage of you. Even though we had some standing as Christ's apostles, we never threw our weight around or tried to come across as important with you or anyone else. We weren't standoffish with you. We took you just as you were. We were never patronizing, never condescending, but we cared for you the way a mother cares for her children. We loved you dearly. Not content to just pass on the message, we wanted to give you our hearts, and we did. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the gathering.
Thanks be to God.
And we'll remain seated as we sing a new commandment, which is on your insert.
Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from Matthew. When the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. "Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest?" He said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Now while the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them this question, "What do you think of the Messiah? Whose son is he?" They said to him, "The son of David." He said to them, "How is it then that David, by the Spirit, calls him Lord, saying, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet'? If David thus calls him Lord, how can he be his son?" No one was able to give him an answer, nor from that day did anyone dare to ask him any more questions. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated. Why is it that we always have three readings to consider each Sunday? The Old Testament reading, the New Testament reading, and the Gospel reading. Is it because the foundation of Christianity is Judaism, and therefore we, as Christians, should know something about the books on which Judaism was built? Or is it because if Jesus came to fulfill the Old Testament, we should know something about what he came to fulfill? Or is it because as human civilization, and particularly Western civilization, evolves, we see patterns of negative behavior that repeat and repeat, and we need to be reminded of this in order to change our ways? I suggest to you that all these three answers are correct. So why should the Christians of St. Edmunds read Deuteronomy? And why specifically should we read about the death of Moses? Now, Deuteronomy is the last of the five books called the Torah, or the Law. And these five books are traditionally called the Books of Moses. And some folk will have you believe that Moses actually wrote them. Now, whether or not this is factually true depends on whether you think Moses would write about his own death and boast that there would never be another prophet like him. But setting the discussion of that aside, is this therefore a passage that needs to be read again and again because there is a claim in verse 4 that the land Moses observed from Mount Nebo, looking out west beyond the Dead Sea to the Mediterranean Sea, is the land promised by Yahweh to the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? A promise that comforted the Hebrew people and legitimized the whole of the book that follows Deuteronomy, the book of Joshua, which details in holy glee the destruction of the Canaanite people who lived in that land, and the consequent establishment of the Kingdom of Israel? Or do we read this in order to enlighten us as to what is happening in that part of the world right now? Or is that too relevant? Should we leave that discussion aside because we don't want to upset people? And Anglicans don't do politics. Or perhaps as mere lay people, we should not venture into giving opinions about the Holy Book. After all, we're not trained in such matters. Or should we remain quiet in case someone should mention that there is a parallel here with the papal edict of 1492, sometimes referred to as the Doctrine of Discovery, which gave holy authority to Christian explorers to murder any opponents of colonialism who refused to take on the gift of the new religion being offered to them? It is perhaps better if we left that alone. It is just so uncomfortable. So let's just play safe and Anglican and imagine a Charlton Heston type Moses lying down to die on a dusty outcrop above the Dead Sea with a few angels hovering above and a familiar funereal tune lifting the camera to the clouds and the sky and the cosmos, and somewhere out there is God. That feels so much better. So why should we read the passage from Thessalonians? At first reading, we have a fairly innocuous passage. Paul reminisces about his first visit to Thessalonica, which is actually an influential town in northern Greece. And he encourages a small group of Christian converts to behave in a mature Christian fashion. But when we look at the visit to Thessalonica as recorded in Acts 17, it's much, much livelier than that. Paul goes into the Jewish synagogue, one of hundreds scattered around the Eastern Mediterranean, and for three Sabbaths he initiates conversation with the leaders of the church, debating with them as to whether the Messiah had arrived. Some of them believed Paul and became the early Christian church in the Jewish synagogue. Others, probably the majority, didn't accept his message. And at the end of 3 weeks, they'd had enough, and they told the secular authorities that Paul was championing another king to rival Caesar. So Paul had to get out of town under cover of darkness and escape to the next town, Berea, where he received a better reception, until the thugs from Thessalonica caught up with him again, and he had another hairbreadth escape. Now this would make a pretty action-packed film, but it is very real. It's the cost of sharing your faith. So it's essential to know what exactly is your faith. What is it that you believe in? What are you prepared to say is really important to you about your Christian faith? I say your faith because I believe, and you may disagree, the wonderful thing about God is that the Spirit of God affects us all in different ways. Now, lots of learned people between 100 and 400 AD decided for us what we should believe in the Christian Catholic faith. So you can believe the Apostles' Creed or the Nicene Creed or whatever the Greek Orthodox Church creed says. And after the Reformation, lots of learned people decided what the breakaway church people should believe, be they Baptists, Lutherans, Wesleyans, Pentecostals, etc. And today we've got learned people telling Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses what they should believe. So we've got lots of choices as to the tenets of our faith. In fact, the choices have evolved to include same-sex marriage. They also include this pure spirituality that comes from sitting in a garden or looking deeply into the petals of a flower or listening to Mozart. For God's creation is everywhere. And God gives us grace to communicate with Him as we feel best. But for the Jewish people, their faith was wrapped up in the Torah, the book of Moses. And God's promise that He would look after them came with the condition, according to the learned men who shaped their holy scriptures, that they must obey the law. If they didn't, they would suffer individually and collectively. And so we turn to Matthew's Gospel. Jesus was what we in the school system call academically gifted. That is, He really shone in one particular subject. His subject was the Torah. He knew it backwards and forwards. At the age of 12, we are told, he went with his parents to Jerusalem and got lost. Well, he knew where he was, but his parents didn't. And when they found him, he was discussing the law with the scribes and the Pharisees, who, no doubt, admired him for his command of the subject. But his spirituality was so advanced that he was already calling Yahweh his father. Discussing the Torah was, he said, going about my father's business. And now, some 20 years later, this precocious child is talking to the same authoritative group. Only now their admiration has become jealousy. They're trying to trick him. First, the Pharisees try to get him in trouble with the Romans by asking him if it's lawful to pay taxes to Caesar. And then the Sadducees, who didn't believe in the afterlife, try to show him how silly his beliefs were by questioning him about marriage in the afterlife. And in both cases, he confounded them with his answers, and they lost face with the general public. Thus, they want revenge. So now they prepare to ask him the biggie. What is the greatest commandment? Remember, God and His law are inseparable. Break His law, any of them, and you are not loving God. Being good lawyers, the Pharisees think they know the answer that Jesus will give before they even ask him the question. Now there are 613 commandments in the Torah. 248 of them are positive thou shalt. And 365, one for every day of the year, thou shalt not. So when he was asked which is the greatest commandment, he had a lot of choice. But they knew that he would answer, thou shalt love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind, because it is the first of the Big Ten. And their response to that would have been, well, we have seen you break God's laws on several occasions, like eating or healing on the Sabbath. So haven't you broken the first commandment? And Jesus answered them exactly as they expected, and they saw the chance to undermine his authority with the crowd. But he quickly followed, "Thou shalt love the Lord your God with, and the second is the same, love your neighbor as you love yourself." Everything in the law depends on those two premises. The second is the same as the first. The second means the same as the first. Showing love for our neighbor is showing love for God. Showing love for our neighbor is showing love for God. Father, we know that we are all chosen, but we pray that all the descendants of Abraham who live in Gaza and Israel will obey the first commandment and the second and live in peace. Amen.
Thank you.
29. Let us confess our faith as we say,
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray for our communities. Let us pray for the world and for the church. Let us pray for those in special need and for our own needs. For our families and friends, that you will bring us a living joy in our rest, our play, and our work. God of love and compassion,
hear our prayer.
For our local community, our province, and our country, that you will help us to cherish the common good. God of love and compassion,
hear our prayer.
For the whole human family, that we may live together with peace, justice, and respect for one another. God of love and compassion,
hear our prayer.
For the people of God, here and in every place, that each one of us may be a true and faithful servant. God of love and compassion,
hear our prayer.
For the witness and mission of the church in all the world, that the good news of Jesus Christ may fill all the earth. God of love and compassion,
hear our prayer.
For those in special need, for the poor and the hungry, for the weak and for the sick, for the lonely and the mistreated, for the grieving and for the dying, that you will comfort and be near them. God of love and compassion,
hear our prayer.
For our daily lives, for all and for all that we do and say and think, for the wrong we do, and for the good we leave undone, that you will release us from sin and renew us. God of love and compassion,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, you have heard the prayers of your faithful people. You know our needs before we ask, and our ignorance in asking. Grant our requests as may be best for us. This we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Now we're singing hymn number 645, our offertory hymn, Come Down, O Love Divine. Thank you.
the bottom of page 31. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you.
Amen.
Let's sing now the Lord's Prayer. Peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia.
We can do a better alleluia than that. Thanks be to God.
Alleluia.